What's going on, everybody? Welcome to part 5 of the Neural Networks from Scratch series. In this video, what we're going to be getting into are activation functions. Specifically, in this video, we're going to talk about the rectified linear as well as the step function and sigmoid functions. And then we'll save the softmax probably for the next video. As always, this video is based on the book, which you can get at nnfs.io. And with that, let's jump into it. And first, let's just cover a overview of what are these activation functions, what are they doing, why are we using them, and so on. And first, we're going to start with the step function, otherwise known as the unit step function, or possibly the Heaviside after Oliver Heaviside. So let's get into that. So for an activation function, you can use a variety of different functions. In this case, we're just going to look at a step function to start. So a step function is very simple. The idea is if your input to this function is greater than 0, then the output will be a 1. Otherwise, the output is going to be a 0. So that's all there is to this step function. And now let's consider using this step function as an activation function. So now taking the step function and using it as an activation function, the way that this works in your entire neural network is each neuron in the hidden layers and the output layers will have this activation function. And this comes into play after you do the inputs times the weights plus the bias. So that value of inputs times the weights plus the bias is what is being fed through your activation function. So as you can see here, as we tweak the weights, we can see how that impacts that output. And the same thing is true with the bias. As we tweak a bias, we can see what kind of changes might be made. The big takeaway here is the output is quite literally a 0 or a 1. So given some pretty complex inputs and tweaking of weights and biases, we can see that for sure the output of this activation function is and will always be either a 0 or a 1, nothing more than that. And this 1 here, or 0 or 1, the output from this activation function, that becomes the input to the next neurons. So on the macro level, again, every neuron in your hidden layers, as well as your output layer, is going to have an activation function associated. Now, what's most common and what you'll see and soon learn why, generally the output layer is going to have a different activation function than what you're using in your hidden layers. But for now, we're just kind of showing an example of a variety of step functions being used as activation functions in this network. So with that in mind, and in mind of the 0 and 1 only outputs, that brings us to the next activation function, which is the sigmoid activation function. Now, while you can have a neural network with an activation function that's a step function, it quickly became obvious that using something like a sigmoid activation function was a little more easy to train a neural network, or a little more reliable for training a neural network due to the granularity of the output. So again, the sigmoid activation function comes in after you do the inputs times the weights plus the bias. The difference of the sigmoid activation function to the step function is that we get a more granular output from this function, which obviously becomes the input to the next layer of neurons. Now, why does this matter? Well, as we proceed, we haven't hit these topics yet, but as we proceed, the next steps are going to be to calculate loss, or how wrong is the neural network, right? And then the next step is to use an optimizer to optimize the weights and the bias values to decrease loss. And in order to do that, we need to know what's the impact of these weights and these biases on these individual values. And with a step function, we just don't have the granularity to know how close were we to, let's say it outputs a 1, how close were we to outputting a 0? Or if it outputs a 0, how close were we to outputting a 1? It's not going to be known to the optimizer. That won't be known. So that is why something like a sigmoid, where you have a more granular output, that becomes more preferable and more reliable to training an entire neural network. This brings us to the rectified linear unit activation function. This function is extremely simple. If x is greater than 0, the output is whatever x is. If x is less than or equal to 0, the output is 0. So again, the rectified linear activation function comes in after we do the inputs times your weights plus your bias. Like the sigmoid activation function, the output can be granular at least. It can't be less than 0, so if enough things are 0, it's still going to output a 0. But this should also kind of help drive home the point of weights and biases being able to weights either flipping the sign or biases offsetting enough in such a way that you still get this granular output. Now, why might we use the rectified linear activation function over something like sigmoid, which also produces this granular output? Well, the sigmoid activation function has an issue referred to as the vanishing gradient problem, which won't really make much sense until we get to gradient. Just know it has a problem. And from there, there's really two main reasons why we use rectified linear. Obviously, because it's granular, so we can still optimize well with it. But the two main reasons why we use rectified linear are it's fast because it's a very simple calculation. So sigmoid function is not super complicated, but it's still much more complex than rectified linear, which is it's just if x is less than 0 or 0, output is 0. Otherwise, output x. Output x is extremely simple, right? So it's super simple. So it's super fast. And finally, it just simply works. So that is the first activation function that we're actually going to take the time to write. And this is the most popular activation function to use for hidden layers in neural networks. So you might be wondering, why do we use an activation function at all? I think most people can understand that the activation function is meant to mimic the neuron in your brain firing or not, but mathematically, what is the point? Why do we even use these? Can we just tune a neural network with weights and biases alone? So if we were just going to use weights and biases, effectively our activation function would be a linear activation function of y equals x. So it would just be whatever the input is, that's the output. So at the singular neuron level, this is pretty obvious, right? If you use a linear activation function, your output is just going to, for sure, be linear. But of course, also, if we extrapolate this out to the entire neural network, all of these outputs have to continue just simply being linear. So with linear activation functions, we really can only fit linear functions. Or if we attempt to fit some nonlinear data, all we can do is approximate using some sort of linear function. If we take a linear activation functioned neural network and attempt to fit a nonlinear function, such as a sine wave, what we see here with the sine wave is that green line, and then the red line is the neural network. This is a real neural network attempting to fit to this sine wave. You see, it just simply can't do it. It's just not possible with linear activation functions. We need some sort of non-linear activation function, and this is why, for a while, we used sigmoid, and then eventually we got into rectified linear. So this is the same two hidden layers of 8 neurons each. It's just those neurons, rather than a linear activation function, are using a rectified linear activation function instead. And as you can see, while it's not perfect because the network is quite small, it's a much better fit than the linear activation function than we were just looking at. And this is where most people would stop and just say, hey, look, this is how it works, and that's that. But the question I had as I was making this video was, okay, but why does it work? What is the magic formula? And the magic formula is everything is built into the fact that these are nonlinear activation functions. So what's so cool about the rectified linear activation function is it's almost linear. It's so close to being linear, but yet that little itty bitty bit of that rectified kind of clipping at zero is exactly what makes it powerful as a sigmoid activation function, super fast, but this is what makes it work, and it's so cool. So why does it work? So starting with just a single neuron using a rectified linear activation function, we can see that we can strengthen, you know, whatever the input is by increasing the weight, right? That makes total sense. With a single neuron, I think understanding how rectified linear is working. And we can offset the activation point by tweaking the bias, right? So we can move this function horizontally, right? And that's how we can offset at what point does this neuron activate. Now, if we negate the weight, then this flips the rectified linear activation from determining at which point the input activates to instead determining at which point the input deactivates. So again, still just a single neuron, but I think relatively easy and expected outputs that have come from just a single neuron with a rectified linear activation function. Now, if we add another neuron with a rectified linear activation function, and we have a bias of 0 and a weights of 1, the actual output remains completely unchanged. If we then adjust the bias of the second neuron, something pretty curious happens to this entire output. The function, the output, is offset just like it was offset by bias before, but it is offset vertically instead. If we negate the weight for the second neuron, however, something else interesting happens. We now have a lower and upper bound for this input information. Now, the output after these two neurons will be variable so long as it's inside of some specific range. So basically, if both neurons are activated, then we actually see this sort of influence on the values. Otherwise, if both neurons aren't activated, then the output is just a static value. It remains unchanged. So when we're below the activation for the first neuron, then the output will be the bias of the second neuron. And if we're below the activation for the second neuron, then the output will just be 0. So now let's consider a model of two hidden layers of 8 neurons each. So the exact same architecture that we showed earlier of a neural network using a linear activation function attempting to fit this sine function, as well as a neural network using the rectified linear activation function in those hidden layers attempting to fit that sine function. So we're going to just set all of the weights to 0, and we're only going to tinker with the weights between the neurons of the same index value in both hidden layers. And we're going to do this just for simplicity's sake, and just to kind of illustrate this concept in such a way for us feeble humans to understand. In general, your optimizer, and we will get to optimizers, is doing things in dimensions that we just don't totally understand very well. So we're going to simplify things and make this easier. And for the record, the optimizer used in this case is the Daniel optimizer. This is indeed a handcrafted optimized neural network. I don't think many people can say that they've done such a thing. So pretty cool. So what we're going to do now is show that how we can fit this green sine function. To begin, we'll set the weight between the two hidden layers' first neurons as 1. Same with the weight between the first neuron in that second hidden layer and the output neuron. Then we'll use the weight from the input to the first neuron to fit those first parts of that sine wave, basically to set the slope. So once we've got that initial slope the way that we wanted, and again, we got that slope by setting the weight coming into that initial neuron. So that weight is going to impact the outputting slope, basically, of that rectified linear. So as you increase the weight, that slope gets steeper and steeper. If you decrease the weight, it gets shallower and shallower. And then eventually, if you go into the negatives, that slope starts to go downward, right? So the current problem that we have is the slope is correct for the first part of this sine wave, but soon we need a different slope. We want something else. So we want to stop the bounds of this pair of neurons. We want to make this bounded. So if you recall from the example before, the way that we set, so the first neuron in this pair of neurons is responsible for the activation point. The second neuron can set the deactivation point. So in order to do that, what we want to do is we're going to change the bias of the second neuron a bit, which moves the overall function vertically, same as the example that we showed before. Next, we're going to adjust the weight coming into the second neuron, which will negate it, and also flip the function from being a question of when the neuron activates to instead being a question of when it deactivates, which is the first step to creating this quote-unquote area of effect. Then, while we are happy now that we've got this, the correct area of effect that we want, right? We can see, okay, that's about where we'd want this neuron to activate. And yep, that's where we'd want it to deactivate. We have a slight problem because we've lost the slope, right, that we wanted. It's the wrong slope now. So to do this, we're going to adjust the weight from the second neuron to the output layer, negating it, which will flip our function back. And now what we have is an area where these two neurons activate as well as deactivate. The slope is correct. Everything looks good. And now it's just simply an alignment issue. So the plan here is to use the top 7 neuron pairs to fit the correct shape of this sine function. And then we're going to use the bottom pair purely for controlling the offset of this function. So moving it exactly where we want. So the first 7 just simply match that kind of the shape and the flow of the sine wave. The last ones we're going to use to actually offset and get it to line up correctly. So now that we've got this first area of effect, we're going to do another area of effect. So to do this, we're just going to go down to the second pair of neurons to create this section. Again, the first order of business is to use the first neuron to set the slope and the activation point exactly where we want. In this case, we want the activation to occur just after the previous area of effect, so to speak. So what we're going to do is we're going to set the incoming weight of 3.5, and we're going to set a bias of negative 0.42. Then again, we have no limit to this activated pair. So we need to do that by offsetting this function a bit with a bias of the second neuron to 0.27, then setting our limit by negating the weight to the second neuron, which allows us to pick the exact deactivation point. Again, same thing that we did before. So in this case, we move from a weight of 1 to negative 1. And then finally, what we're going to do is change the weight from the second neuron to the output neuron, the same amount in this case, from a 1 to a negative 1 to offset, and now we've got that same slope as before. So again, we just need to revisit that bottom pair of neurons to make our final adjustment, in this case, setting that final weight to the output neuron as 0.97 seems to line everything up again. So moving on to the third pair of neurons here, we're going to use the same exact methodology. The first neuron sets the activation point and the slope. In this case, we actually want the activation point to begin a bit after the deactivation point from that previous pair, because we're actually going to use the no pair of neurons is activated to be that top of that sine curve. So actually, we're going to begin our activation a bit after that. Our slope is going to be negative, and then we again use the second neuron in this pair to set the deactivation point. And then from here, I mean, we basically just continue this simple methodology for mapping this. And again, this is a handcrafted example. An optimizer might not do it exactly this way, but this is a way for us to exemplify to you how a pair of neurons with a rectified linear or really any nonlinear activation function can fit to a nonlinear problem. And once we're done fitting all of this, and again, the way that we did it was that the first 7 pairs is for the activation point, the deactivation point, and the slope, and the offset of that specific function. And then that the last pair of neurons we're using to offset the entire operation. And now we're done. So we can simulate the range of input showing where activation occurs and stops for each pair of neurons and how this impacts the overall function and output of this neural network. So you can see how individual neurons become responsible for only really small sections and parts of the overall neural network function, which is really cool. So you can kind of see as it's only when both neurons are activated that their quote unquote area of effect comes into play. And so as we're kind of moving over this sine wave, because we did things in order, again, a real optimizer wouldn't necessarily maintain such order. So the Daniel optimizer did though. And so these, you can just see as we move through this sine wave that the first pairs get activated, then the second pair together, then the third. And throughout this whole thing, sometimes certain ones get activated, but it's only when both are activated that their area of effect comes into play. So one of the more important fields and challenging fields for deep learning right now is figuring out why neural networks do the things that they do and assign certain classifications. So when we're giving more and more power to artificial intelligence to make decisions about things like just driving us around in cars, or who gets a loan and who doesn't get a loan, and so on. We need to have some sort of way of auditing these otherwise kind of black box AI machines. We need to know the why about how certain things are happening, and especially if things go wrong, why did that happen? So we need more people who can understand and actually kind of debug neural networks. And yet again, this is just a reason why building them from scratch and hopefully seeing things like we've shown here can give you an idea and intuition of how all this works. I mean, the rectified linear activation function is so simple, yet the power it gives us when we throw it in here, it's truly fascinating. But anyway, if you find this interesting, I would encourage you to dig deeper into the field of understanding how neural networks and why neural networks reach the conclusions that they do, because that is an area that needs a lot of help. Now again, just for example purposes, we left out most of the weights. We only actually tweaked the weights between the two similarly indexed neurons in our hidden layers, so we could understand the example. But if we bring in all the weights and then allow a real optimizer to train, we can see that fitment improves substantially, because there's even more properties that are coming into play by allowing all of these weights. But things start to happen and exceed our understanding pretty quickly. So this is actually pretty good fitment, even though we have very few neurons. If we have two layers of 64 neurons each instead of the 8 that we use here, you should see considerably even more improvement. And I hope that you can understand now why we have more quote unquote areas of effect that we can do. So anyways, I hope that this has been very illustrative into your understanding of how these neurons are working together. Even more information now on how weights and biases work, because now, as you've seen, yes, in the context of a single neuron and its activation function, weights and biases do one thing, but then when you have a neuron that's connected to another neuron, suddenly we get even more interesting things are happening, and this other properties are happening, and that's really cool. So anyways, hopefully that makes at least as much sense as it's supposed to. And that's why, in order to fit nonlinear problems with neural networks, we need two or more hidden layers. And with those two hidden layers, that's why we use nonlinear activation functions. Okay, so now coming over to our code, what we're going to do is we'll leave most of this code here, but I'm actually going to, I guess, just comment this out for now. And let's just write a really simple example of this rectified linear function. So I'm going to use the same values from the book. So I'm literally just going to copy 0, 2, negative 1, 3.3, negative 2.7, 1.1, 2.2, negative 100. And confirm negative 2.7. Looks good. Okay. So then what we're going to say, so those will be the inputs. Now the output is going to just be an empty list to start. And then what we're going to say is for, I, in inputs, what we're going to say is if input is, or actually if I is greater than 0, then we're going to output dot append I, and then elif I is less than or equal to 0, then output dot append 0. And that is the rectified linear activation function. So we can print output. Run that, and what we get here is basically everything is clipped from 0 and below to be 0. So I think that's a pretty simple concept. If you're following along in another language, I think you can probably implement something like that. The next thing is, again, still in raw Python, the other option we have is to quite simply output.append the max of either 0 or I, right? And then we can run that, and again, we see we get the exact same thing. So it's just append the maximum of 0 or I. So if I is less than 0, then 0 is the max, right? So pretty simple. Okay, so now what we want to do is actually write the rectified linear object, because we'd like this. Basically, what we want to do is we want to have these objects that, as time goes on and we build out the code, we need objects that have both a forward method and this backward method for doing forward pass and back pass. So that's why we're going to do this. So for now, this rectified linear object is going to look kind of silly in its simplicity, but soon it will be a little more advanced. So I'm going to copy the name from the book. It's activation underscore ReLU. So class activation underscore ReLU. So the RE is rectified and then linear unit. And then again here, we're going to define a forward method. It's going to take self and inputs, and it's going to produce a self.output. And we're going to say the output is just np.maximum of the of zero and inputs. So, okay. So that is our the forward method for the activation function that is the rectified linear unit activation function. Now, a couple of people have been asking questions about our naming convention here and that it's not PEP8. So as a reminder, PEP8 is a styling suggestion. And I know that many people would like to remove that basically and do maybe something like that and so on. The idea here is that we're going to have many different types of layers, and that's just how we're going to organize them. If you really wanted to be official, the way that you would do it is you would have separate directories that would be like your layer directories. So you would from, you know, whatever package dot layers import dense or something like that, right? That's how you would do it. That's how all the major packages are doing it. We're going to try to keep everything simple and in one file. I think it's easier to learn that way. Daniel agrees. So we're going to keep it this way. If you want to change the names, by all means, do that. It's really up to you. We're here to teach you neural networks from scratch so that you can do this however the heck you want. That's kind of the beauty. So with that in mind, now that we've got this activation function ready to rumble, we could use it, but the next thing I want to show you guys and that I want us to use is we're going to use the NNFS package. So to get that, you can pip install NNFS, and that will give you the package. Also, as time goes on, especially if you want to use the NNFS tool, which I'm going to explain in a minute, you'll want to upgrade, you know, pip install dash dash upgrade NNFS so you can get the newer versions of the code. But to show you that, if you just, after you've installed that, you should get the NNFS tool, which you can use to mainly at the moment generate the code files. So for example, if you type NNFS and then code, the part number, and then the file name that you want, this will give you a copy of the code for that part number. So if you want to get the sample code that way, you can also just use the GitHub page and so on. We might add more stuff to this tool later on. Just know it exists. And if you're going to use that, you'll need to upgrade to get the later parts because they're not there. The main thing and the main reason why we're going to use, actually there's two reasons we're going to use this NNFS package. The first is for stuff like NumPy. So our goal and our hope here is that everybody can follow along and get the same values as we do, at least if they want to. Obviously, again, if you're following along in another language, or maybe you want to change things and not do things exactly the same way as I'm doing, which is totally fine. But if you want to confirm that you're doing things correctly, you need to be able to repeat the results that we get. So we're trying to make that possible. So the one thing that we're doing, first of all, the random seed, again, we were setting that so hopefully your random would generate the values that we're getting. But if you're following along, for example, in a notebook, that won't work unless you do that and run all the same code in a cell. So it won't work very well, just as a heads up. But you'll also need to always be doing that. So instead, what we're going to do is we're going to import NNFS and then do NNFS.init. And besides setting the random seed, the other thing NNFS init is doing for us is it's setting a default data type for NumPy to use. So for whatever reason, the dot product for NumPy, we only found this out after getting many people in the document and finding some people were getting slightly different values, and it was very weird. But it turns out the dot product sometimes will use a different data type, and there's no way to set a default data type in NumPy. It just decides, I suppose. So instead, what we're doing here is we're overriding some things and going to set so everyone uses the same data type. Anyway, if you're in another language, don't worry about it. But if you want to be able to replicate everything, that's how. The next thing that we're going to use the NNFS package for is the data set. Again, if you're following along in another language, I'll either copy and paste this in the description. If I forget to, someone remind me. But anyways, we're going to use this as our data set. And again, this is just a function that will generate some data for us. Eventually, we'll use a real data set, but when we're trying to learn things, it's kind of useful for us to be able to specify exactly what we need, of exactly what size, however many classes, however sparse, you know, you can make so many tweaks here and just generate a data set that's either easy or hard and so on. So it just makes a lot of sense at this stage that, one, we don't want to hand type anymore, but also it's just very convenient to use a data set like this that we just create just for learning purposes. So again, if you, if you're in another language, you'll probably need to recreate this in some way, or you can use a different data set. Like, again, it's all up to you guys what you want to do. So this function here is actually, slightly modified from the following CS, 231 course, which I'll bring up for a moment. And what's cool about this course is it's a heavily truncated version of what we're doing here. I don't think anybody who's following along here, if you're following along and actually don't know how neural networks work, I think you're going to have a really hard time following along here. But instead, what I think what this would be useful for is for review. So as we learn about things, especially when you're done, you might try to come here and use this as a second resource to review or just see, like, do I understand how they're doing everything here? But anyway, the function that we're using is kind of modified of this, which generates a spiral data set. So I'm going to show you what that looks like. Run that. And what you get is this data set. So you already know it spirals, but if you were told, hey, there's three classes here, you know, you might notice, like, hey, maybe that's a class, this is a class, and then maybe this is a class. But then, like, what about, like, in this area? It's a kind of challenging one, especially even here. Like, we know they're all coming from the point of origin, but really I only see two spirals coming out of this origin here. So it's already actually a pretty challenging data set, but then when we color it, it becomes a little more obvious. So here's one spiral, here's two spirals. But as you can see, like, especially green and blue here, they're overlapping quite a bit. Like, especially like this here, this is a pretty challenging data set for any machine learning algorithm, but even a human, I think you would find it pretty hard to solve this data set. So anyway, it makes for a pretty good data set for us to practice on. And the idea here of our function is basically you pass how many points, basically data set points do you want? So this will be how many feature sets per however many classes you have. So in this case, we're just creating these x and y coordinates, basically. So every feature set is only going to have two features that describe what class this thing is. And then this is however many classes. So in this case, we created three classes. So three classes of 100 feature sets each. Each feature set is two descriptive features. So just to totally clarify that, that's like our example before was where we were trying to predict server failure, right? And in our feature sets, we had four features, and we were saying each feature is like a reading from a sensor. So in this case, we have three classifications for something. We've got 100 feature sets, and inside those feature sets, we have two. So two features rather than four features. Hopefully that makes sense. Hopefully everybody's following along at that point. But basically, we just have these two data points that should be informative in some way of what group or class that thing is. If you're confused, please post questions below. If enough people are confused, we could probably create some sort of animation to depict what's going on there, if necessary. So that's the data set. And if you're using NNFS, you're just going to say from nnfs.datasets, import spiral_data. And then to create the data, where the spiral data function produces both your features and your labels. So we're going to say X, Y. So again, capital X just denotes your feature sets in machine learning in general. Lowercase y is like the targets or the classification. So X comma Y equals spiral data. And we'll say we're going to have 100 feature sets of three classes. And that will be our data. The next thing is we'll just do one layer for now. And I guess we'll delete this. And so again, let's delete layer two as well. So as a reminder and slight review, so layer dense, this is going to be that first layer from our input data, which is our currently just basically this X. So what was this, right? What was this for? This was the number of inputs. And then five was the number of neurons. Now, if you recall from the previous video, you could make that you know, 5, whatever the heck you wanted, right? It could be any number, right? It was the first number here that's like the input data. What is the size of the input data? So again, what was that 4 talking about? That was the number of features per sample for our whether or not a server is going to fail, right? In this case, like I was saying before, because you, as you've seen, it just it creates a graph of XY data, right? So that means we have 2 unique features that describe this data set, right? So in this case, rather than 4, it becomes a 2. So that's our layer 1. And the next thing that we're going to define is our activation function. So we're just going to say activation 1, and that will be activation ReLU. That will just be a ReLU object. So in this case, what we're doing is we're going to have this activation ReLU. As you can see here, this is going to be input. So it's going to take all of the values from our neurons and produce the activation for this entire layer. Now, again, you don't have to actually have the same activation functions in that entire layer. They could be mixed. I can't say I've ever seen anyone do it. And in this case, the way that we've coded things, it's not going to work if you wanted to do that. But again, you should be able to do that if you want. But in this case, it's going to apply this activation function to the entire current output of layer 1. So after we do this layer 1.forward, so we've passed data to, at this point, at layer 1.forward, what we've done is inputs times the weights plus the bias, right? We've done this calculation when we run forward. So now layer 1 has a dot output, right? So what we could say is we could call this, let me make sure I call this the same thing that we do in the book. So yeah, we'll just run, actually I'm not even calling it anything in the book. So we're just going to simply run activation one, and then we'll run a forward. And then what will we put in here? It's going to be the layer one dot output. And that will run everything through. So in fact, let's print layer one dot output, just so we can see it right before we run it through the activation function. So in this case, you can see lots of negative values. Okay, there are some positive values, but there's also many negatives. So what we expect to see after we feed it through here, because that's negative values after we've done the weights and the biases, right? So now it's going to go through that rectified linear function, and that should make all of those negatives a 0. Okay, so that's our expectation. Hopefully we'll find that is true. So we do activation 1 forward, layer 1 output, and then now what we can do is print the values from activation 1. So activation 1 output, we'll comment out the other print. Let's go ahead and run that. We typoed. Forward. save that, run that. And sure enough, what we see is no negative values, many 0 values. And you might think that, oh, that's going to be a problem. Well, when the optimizer goes to start optimizing things, those values are going to get tweaked over time, and we probably will see as training occurs that we won't have as many just purely, you know, 0 worthless values. That's the hope. And again, if we do find that, wow, everything's going to 0, the network is dying, recall that one of the fixes that we could make immediately to solve for this is to initialize biases to some sort of non-zero number, for example. It will unlikely be the case that this is going to be a problem, but now you know. How could we check that? Well, you just print it out, right? Look at it. That's how you could, you know, begin to diagnose some of these errors. Anyway, a lot of information for, honestly, basically this. but hopefully you understand now what activation functions are doing and why we use activation functions and the rectified linear activation function, which sounds kind of complicated, or it sounds complex. It's a cool name, but it's actually unbelievably simple. So anyways, that's it for the rectified linear activation function. In the next tutorial, what we're going to be talking about is the softmax activation function, which is a bit more advanced and really more specific to the output layer, which we kind of hope will be a distribution, but we'll explain that in the next video. Again, if you want to check out the book and get a jump on the material in advance, you can check out the book at nnfs.io, where we are much, much further beyond the softmax activation function. It's actually training full loop. And hopefully at some point it won't even be a pre-order. The book will be done. At least at the time of my recording this, we're all the way through to you know, fully training a model with optimizing and backpropagation. All of that stuff is already done. So check that out if you want to get a jump on the material or just review it before or after and all that. So anyways, nnfs.io. Questions, comments, concerns, whatever, feel free to leave those below. Otherwise, I will see you guys in the next video.